Student, in the previous chapter, we have learnt about the three states of matter and their physical properties. In the present unit, we shall study about the chemical nature of matter. So, the name of the chapter is Matter Around Us Pure, chapter number 2 of class 9. So, let us first understand the scientific meaning of the term chemical substance. The scientific meaning of the term chemical substance is different from its everyday meaning. In terms of science, substance is a kind of matter that cannot be separated into other kinds of matter by any physical process. In other words, substance is a pure form of matter and not a mixture of several different kinds of matter. Most of the things we use in our day-to-day life are in the form of mixtures. Pure substances are rare. For example, the dissolved sugar can be separated from its solution by some physical process like evaporation or distillation. However, sugar is itself a substance and cannot be separated by physical processes into its constituents. Similarly, common salt or sodium chloride, iron, mercury, calcium oxide, hydrochloric acid are substances. On the other hand, soft drink, air, soil, etc. are not single substances in scientific sense. They are a mixture. Now, what is a pure substance? When we go to the market, we notice the word pure written on the packets of many items. On a packet of milk, ghee, butter, fruit juice, etc. For a common person, this means that there is no adulteration in these things and therefore these are pure. However, according to scientists, these may not be pure. According to scientists, a pure substance means that it is a single substance. For example, milk is not pure because it is not a single substance. Milk is actually a mixture of many different substances such as water, fats, proteins, etc. We sometimes say that air of this place is pure. This simply means that air at that place does not have pollution. Scientifically, air is not a pure substance because it is a mixture of several gases and water vapors. According to scientists, a pure substance consists of a single type of particles. This means that all the constituent particles of a pure substance are the same in their chemical nature. Thus, a pure substance represents a single substance. Now, how to test for a pure substance? The purity of a substance can be tested by checking its melting point or boiling point. A pure substance has a fixed melting point or boiling point at constant pressure. The melting and boiling point of a substance will change if it contains even a tiny amount of another substance. For example, pure water has boiling point of 373 Kelvin at normal atmospheric pressure, that is 1 atmosphere, but water containing some salt will boil over a range of temperature above 373 Kelvin. Now, moving on to mixtures. Most of the materials that we come across in our daily life are mixtures. Mixtures contain more than one substances, elements or compounds. A mixture may be solid, liquid or gas. For example, water from a pond or a river is a mixture of many salts, sand and clay particles. The water that we drink also contains very small amount of various salts dissolved in it. The air around us is a mixture of some gases such as oxygen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, argon and water vapor. Some dust particles and smoke particles are also present in air. Many substances such as milk, jaggery, sherbet drink, etc. which appear to contain only one type of substance are in fact mixtures. They contain different types of substances present in them. Thus, mixture is made up of two or more substances. The substances which make a mixture are called constituents or components. The components of a mixture retain their properties. The properties of a mixture are those of the substance of which mixture is made up of. For example, lemonade is a mixture of water, lemon juice, sugar and salt. When we drink it, we get the sour taste of lemon, sultry taste of salt and sweet taste of sugar. Moreover, since it contains water also. It quenches our thirst like water. A mixture can be separated by physical method into its two or more pure substances. For example, sodium chloride dissolved in water can be separated from water by the physical process of evaporation. However, sodium chloride is itself a substance and cannot be separated by any physical process into its chemical constituents. The mixture can also be obtained by mixing two or more pure substances without any chemical change in any proportion. Depending upon the nature of the components which form the mixtures, we have different types of mixtures. Types of mixture. Mixtures are of two types, homogeneous mixture and heterogeneous mixture. A mixture is said to be homogeneous if it has the same composition throughout the sample. A homogeneous mixture has no visible boundaries or separation between various constituents, for example, salt solution, sugar solution, and carbonated water. A mixture is said to be heterogeneous mixture if it consists of two or more parts which have different compositions. It has visible boundaries of separation between the various constituents. For example, undissolved sugar in sugar solution, smoke, mixture of iron and sulfur, mixture of sand and water, mixture of sodium chloride and iron fillings, salt and sulfur, oil and water, etc. In our daily life, we usually deal with the mixture rather than pure substances. For example, sometimes we can easily identify a mixture of substances by appearance. For example, when we take powdered chalk and water, a milky liquid is formed. This is a mixture of water with the chalk particles suspended in it and can be easily identified with the naked eyes. But if we see milk, it appears to be a homogeneous mixture. However, if we observe milk with the help of a microscope, it appears as drops of fat suspended in a clear liquid. Thus, milk is also a heterogeneous mixture. Let us consider a homogeneous mixture when we shake sugar solution in water, a clear solution of sugar is obtained. The particles of sugar dissolved in water cannot be seen even with the help of a microscope. But the presence of sugar in the liquid can be easily detected if a drop of the solution is placed on a glass plate and allowed to dry. Sugar particles will remain on the glass as water evaporates. Now, next one, what is solution? A solution is a homogeneous mixture of two or more substances. We come across many types of solutions in our daily life. The lemonade, sherbet, Coke, Pepsi are examples of solution. At particle level, there is homogeneity. For example, a lemonade has same taste throughout. This shows that the particles of sugar or salt are evenly distributed in solution. The substances making up the solution are called components of the solution. A solution is generally made up of two components, solvent and solute. A component which is present in large amount is called solvent, while the component which is present in lesser amount is called solute. Thus, a solute is a substance which dissolves, and the solvent is a substance in which dissolution takes place. For example, if a crystal of sugar is dropped into a beaker of water, it dissolves to form a solution. These solutions are called true solution because the particles of solution have very small size, less than 10 to the power minus 9 meter or 1 nanometer or 10 to the power minus 7 centimeter. We come across various types of solutions in our daily life. It may be noted that most of the common solutions contain solid solutes and liquid solvents. For example, sugar dissolved in water to prepare sherbet. However, the solutes may be even liquids or gases. All these are called liquid solutions. Mixtures of miscible liquids is a common example of liquid and liquid solutions. And carbon dioxide dissolved in water is a common example of gas and liquid solutions. Now, aqueous and non-aqueous solutions. The solutions can be classified as aqueous and non-aqueous solutions. The solutions which obtained by dissolving various substances in water are called aqueous solutions. Example, common salt dissolved in water, sugar dissolved in water, acetic acid dissolved in water called vinegar. The solution obtained by dissolving substances in liquid other than water are called non-aqueous solutions. The common non-aqueous solvents are alcohol, carbon disulfide, carbon tetrachloride, acetone, benzene, etc. Examples of non-aqueous solutions are iodine dissolved in carbon tetrachloride, sulfur dissolved in carbon disulfide, bromine dissolved in chloroform, sugar dissolved in alcohol. Now the properties of solutions. A solution is homogeneous in nature. It may be noted that in a solution there is homogeneity at micro level. The size of the particle of solution is less than 10 to the power minus 9 meter or 1 meter, 1 nanometer. They cannot be seen with naked eye. The particles of the solutions cannot be seen even with the help of microscope. The particles of the solution easily pass through a filter paper. Therefore, they cannot be separated by the process of filtration. The solute particles in solution do not settle on keeping, that is, the solution is stable. Because of very small size, they do not scatter a beam of light passing through the solution, so the path of the light is not visible in a solution. Now let us do some questions related to mass concentration. So first of all, first question is, a given solution contains 40 gram of solution in 320 gram of water. Calculate the concentration of solution. Now first of all, you have to write given. So what is given? Mass of sugar is given, that is 40 gram. Mass of water is given, that is 320 gram. So as you know, if we have to find out total concentration of mass, so what we have to do? We have to add mass of solute plus mass of solvent. So mass of solution would be 360 gram. Now, the question is asking that you have to find out concentration of solution. The concentration of solution formula is mass percentage of solution equals to mass of solute upon mass of solution into 100. So if we calculate, the answer will be 11.1%. Now next question is, if 55 gram of salt are present in 550 gram of solution, what is the concentration of the solution? So the concentration of solution we have to find out. So in the similar way, we will write, first of all, given mass of solute equals to 55 gram, mass of solution equals to 550 gram. So concentration of solution will be mass of solute upon mass of solution into 100. So the answer will be 10%. Now the question number 3 is, a solution contains 50 milliliter of ethyl alcohol mixed with 150 milliliter of water. Calculate the concentration of the solution. Now this one is based on volume. So the volume of solute is 50 milliliter. Volume of solvent is 150 milliliter. So the volume of solution equals to volume of solute plus volume of solvent equals to 200 milliliter. Now the concentration of solution equals to volume of solute upon volume of solution into 100. So the answer will be 25%. Now moving on forward, so we have to discuss about different types of solubilities. First solubility is saturated solution, then unsaturated solution, then supersaturated solution. So suppose 1 spoon of sugar is added to about 200 milliliter of water in a beaker at 25 degrees Celsius. On stirring, the sugar dissolves and disappears. If 1 or more spoon of sugar is added to the solution, it also dissolves in this. So we can dissolve different amount of same solute in same quantity of solvent. Therefore, we can prepare solutions of different concentrations of a substance. A particular solution may contain less amount of the dissolved solute, whereas another solution may contain a large amount of the solute. Depending upon the amount of solute present, solution may be classified as unsaturated solution and saturation solution. So a solution in which no more solute can be added at a given temperature is called saturated solution. On the other hand, a solution in which the amount of solute is less than the saturated solution is called unsaturated solution. In other words, in an unsaturated solution, more quantity of solute can be dissolved at a given temperature. Sometimes a solution may contain more amount of solute than the saturation concentration. If a solution contains more amount of solute than the saturation level, it is called supersaturated solution. So now moving on forward, we will discuss about what is suspension. Suspension is a heterogeneous mixture which contains small insoluble particles of solute spread throughout the solvent without dissolving it. So in suspensions, the solute particles do not dissolve but remain suspended throughout the bulk of the medium. The mixtures obtained by these are, for example, muddy water, chalk water, paint, smoke in the air are suspensions. Sparingly soluble Salts such as barium sulfate dispersed in water is also an example of solution. It is used for diagnostic X-rays. The particle size of the solution particles is greater than 10 to the power minus 7 meter or 10 to the power minus 5 centimeter. These particles may or may not be visible to naked eyes but are visible under microscope. Now the properties of suspensions. Suspension is a heterogeneous mixture. Particles of mixture are bigger than 10 to the power minus 7 meter or 100 nanometer in diameter. The particles of suspension may or may not be visible by naked eyes, but they are visible under microscope. The particles of suspension scatter a beam of light passing through it and make its path visible. The particles of suspension settle down when left undisturbed. Therefore, suspension is unstable. The suspension can be separated from the mixture by the process of filtration. Now, moving on to colloidal solution. A colloidal solution is a solution in which the size of the solute particles is intermediate between those in true solutions and suspensions. In other words, the particles of colloidal solution are bigger than particles of true solutions but smaller than particles of suspension. The common example of colloidal solutions are milk, gum solutions, blood, milk, cream, ink, soap, etc. The mixtures obtained are of between 10 to the power minus 7 meter and 10 to the power minus 9 meter. Due to relatively small size of particles as compared to a suspension, the mixture appears to be homogeneous. But actually, a colloidal solution is a heterogeneous mixture. It consists of two phases, that is, dispersal phase and dispersion medium. Dispersed phase is the component which is present in small proportions and consists of particles of colloidal dimensions, while dispersion medium is a component which is present in excess and acts as a medium in which colloidal particles are dispersed. Now moving on to next one, that is Brownian movement. The colloidal particles are moving at random in a zigzag motion in all directions. The zigzag motion of a colloidal particles is called Brownian movement. So this can be shown in the picture. Brownian movement is caused by the collision of the colloidal particles with the molecules of the dispersion medium. Now moving on to next one, that is Tyndall effect of colloids. The size of colloidal particles are too small to be seen by naked eyes. However, they exhibit a property known as Tyndall effect. When a strong beam of light is passed through a solution in a beaker in dark room, the path of the light does not become visible. However, if the same beam of light is passed through the colloidal solution, it is placed in the same room, the path of the light becomes visible when seen from a direction at right angle so that of the incident beam. This effect can also be observed when a fine beam of light falls in a room through a small hole in the window. This phenomenon was studied for the first time by Tyndall and therefore it is called Tyndall effect. This effect is due to scattering of light by colloidal particles. The particles in true solutions are too small in size to cause any scattering. Therefore, Tyndall effect is not observed in true solutions. The phenomenon of scattering of light by colloidal particles is a result of which the path of the beam becomes visible is called Tyndall effect. Tyndall effect can be seen when light from a torch is directed on the solution of copper sulfate and mixture of water and milk. It is observed that beam of light becomes visible in case of mixture of water and milk. This demonstrates the colloidal solution scatters a beam of light that shows Tyndall effect. Tyndall effect can also be observed when a sunlight passes through a dense forest. In the forest, fog contains tiny droplets of water which act as particles of colloid dispersed in air. So let us sum up the properties of colloids. The colloids is a heterogeneous mixture. It consists of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. The size of particles of a colloid is in between 1 nanometer and 100 nanometer. The particles of colloids are too small to be seen by naked eyes. The particles of colloids are large enough to scatter a beam of light passing through it and make its path visible. Thus, they show Tyndall effect. A colloid is quite stable. Its particles do not settle down when left undisturbed. The particles of colloidal solution cannot be separated from the mixture by the process of filtration. However, they can be separated by a special technique known as centrifugation. Separating the components of a mixture. So we have learned that most of the naturally occurring substances are not chemically pure. We use some of these as such in our daily life. In many materials, we have to separate the useful components from the unwanted components before we can use them. Different methods are used to get individual components from the mixture. The separation of components of a mixture is necessary to get pure and useful components. The heterogeneous mixture can be readily separated into their respective components by simple physical methods, such as hand-picking, sieving, sedimentation, decantation, filtration, etc., which we use in our day-to-day life. Sometimes, special techniques are to be used for separation of components of mixtures. You have already learned some simple methods of separation of mixtures in your earlier classes. Let us learn some more method of separation of components of mixture by performing some activities. First one is how we can obtain colored components, that is dye, from blue or black ink. To learn about the method, let us perform a simple activity. Take a beaker, a wash glass which can rest on the mouth of a beaker, a burner and some blue ink. Fill half the beaker with water. Place wash glass on the mouth of the beaker. Put a few drops of ink on the wash glass. Now start heating the beaker. It may be noted that we should not heat ink directly. Therefore, this arrangement is needed. You will observe that evaporation is taking place from the wash glass. Continue heating till evaporation goes on and stop when you do not see any further change on the wash glass. Observe the changes carefully and make records. Now, question arises, what has evaporated from the wash glass? Is there a residue left on the wash glass? What do you conclude? Is ink a single substance or is it a mixture? We observe that ink is a mixture of a dye in water. The dye remains on the wash glass whereas water evaporates. This process of separating any substance from its solution by removing water is called evaporation. In the hot sun, water evaporates and salt is left behind. The salt is then collected in heaps and packed. Now the second one is how to separate cream from milk. Nowadays, we get different varieties of milk such as full cream milk, toned milk, double toned milk, etc. packed in the poly packs of Tetra packs. These varieties of milk contain different amount of milk fat. We generally require cream of different purposes. This can be obtained from milk. This method can be learned by the following activity. Take some full cream milk in a test tube. Churn the cream using a centrifugal machine for 2 to 3 minutes. If centrifugal machine is not available, you can do it with the help of a churner used in the kitchen. For this, take milk in a jug and churn with a churner for 4-5 minutes. What do you observe on churning on centrifugation in the milk? We observe that before churning or centrifugation, the solid particles were uniformly mixed all through the liquid. After centrifuging, the lighter cream has collected at the top and milk without cream has remained below. Cream can be separated from the milk. This method of separating the solid particles suspended in a liquid is called centrifugation, as discussed. So, centrifugation is a method for separating the particles suspended in a liquid. Sometimes, the solid particles in a liquid are too small and readily pass through a filter paper. These solid particles can be separated with the help of a machine known as centrifugal machine. The machine can be rotated at very high speed. The principle of this process is that the denser particles are forced to the bottom and the lighter particles stay at the top when spun rapidly. So, in the suspension of particles suspended in a liquid, the heavier particles settle down the bottom of test tubes. This method of separation finds its importance when the test tubes are rotated at a very high speed. One material is heavier than the other. Now, the applications of centrifugation. The process of centrifuging is used in dairies and homes to separate butter from cream. For this, cream is centrifuged and the butter being lighter floats at the top. It is easily removed. In homes, this method of separation is made use in a mixture grinder, commonly called mixie. It is a very useful kitchen appliance. It is used in washing machine to squeeze out water from the wet clothes. It is extremely used in diagnostic laboratories for different tests of bloods and urine.
Last application is, it is used in chemical laboratories and industries for separating suspended materials from liquid. Now, third separation method is, how to separate a mixture of two immiscible liquids. The immiscible liquids can be separated by separating funnel. A separating funnel is shown in the picture. Let us learn this method for separating olive oil or mustard oil in water by performing the following activity. Take the mixture of mustard or kerosene or olive oil in water. Pour the mixture in the separating funnel. Allow it to stand undisturbed for some time till separate layers of oil and water are formed. Now, what you will observe? Mustard oil forms the upper layer, water forms the lower layer. Open the stop cork of the separating funnel and pour the lower layer carefully in a beaker. Close the stop cork as the oil reaches down and is left behind in the separating funnel. So we have learned that when the two liquids are immiscible, they can be easily separated with the help of a separating funnel. The principle of the method is that immiscible liquids separate out in layers depending on their densities. However, it may be noted that a small amount of the mixture remains unseparated. Now, what would be the application of this method? The method is used to separate a mixture of oil and water to separate some organic compounds present in aqueous solution. For the extraction of iron during its metallurgy, the lighter slag is removed from the top by this method to leave the molten iron at the bottom of the furnace. Now, the fourth separating method is how to separate a mixture of common salt and ammonium chloride. We have learned in the previous chapter that most of the solids first change into liquid and then into their gaseous state. However, some liquids on heating change directly to their gaseous states without changing into liquid. This process, in which a solid changes directly into gaseous state without changing into its liquid state, is called sublimation. Some common examples of solids which sublime are ammonium chloride, camphor, naphthalene, anthracene, benzoic acid, etc. Thus, to separate a mixture which contains a sublimable volatile component from a non-sublimable impurity, the process of sublimation is used. For example, a mixture of common salt and camphor can be separated by this method. Now, the experiment is, take a mixture of common salt and ammonium chloride, put the mixture in a china dish, cover the mixture with an inverted glass funnel, heat the china dish slowly till white fumes starts coming out of the open end of the inverted funnel. Now, plug the open end of the funnel with cotton. Stop heating and allow the funnel to cool. Observe the inner side of the funnel and the contents in the china dish. Now, what do you observe? You will observe that ammonium chloride has deposited on the walls of the funnel. This is because ammonium chloride changed from solid to its vapor form directly without changing into its liquid form. It has cooled down on the inner sides of the funnel. The common salt is left in the china dish. So, sublimation process can be used for separating those substances which sublime on heating. Now, the next separation method, how to separate a mixture of two miscible liquids. Two miscible liquids can be separated by a process known as simple distillation. In this process, the liquid is heated to its boiling point so that it converted to vapors. On cooling the vapors, pure liquid is obtained and collected separately. The apparatus used for the process is shown in the picture. It consists of a flask known as distillation flask having a slide of a tube connected to a condenser. The mixture to be separated is taken in the flask. The flask is gently heated on a water bath or even directly. The liquid having lower boiling point will vaporize fast first, and when it passes through the condenser, the vapors get condensed in the liquid form. Water is passed through the condenser which cools the vapor. In this way, the whole of the component having low boiling point is collected in the receiver and the other component having high boiling point remains in the flask. Application of simple distillation. This method is used for separation of two miscible liquids that boil without decomposition and have sufficient difference in their boiling point. Separation of volatile liquids from non-volatile impurities. Now, next one is how to obtain gases from air. Air is a homogeneous mixture of many gases. The gases can be separated from air by fractional distillation. This method is generally used to separate a mixture of two or more miscible liquids which have boiling points close to each other. In these cases, the process of simple distillation will fail because the vapors of both the liquids will be formed because they have close boiling points. To solve the problem, a special distillation known as fractional distillation is done. In this method, some obstructions are provided to the passage of vapors. This is shown in the figure. The fractional column is a tube packed with glass beads. These beads provide surface for vapors to cool and condense. Gases are separated from air by fractional distillation method. In this method, the air is cooled and compressed by applying pressure and decreasing temperature. Air will be compressed to form liquid air called liquefied air. Then liquefied air is subjected to fractional distillation and different gases are collected at different times. Now 8-1-8 separation technique is the dye in the blue black ink a single color? So as we have learned that dye from blue or black ink can be separated from ink by evaporation. Let us check whether the dye is a single color or not. This can be learned by a method known as chromatography. This is a special method to separate small amounts of dissolved solids. Let us learn this technique by performing the following activity. Take a strip of filter paper, a gas jar or tall glass or beaker and water soluble ink. For this, check the solubility of ink in water by taking a small amount of ink and adding water. Perform the following activity. Draw a line with a pencil approximately 1 inch above from the smaller edge. Put a small drop of ink in the center of line with the help of a thin capillary tube or an ink pen. Dry it. Lower the filter paper till the line up into the jar or tall glass or test tube containing water. Leave it undisturbed for some time. What do you observe on the filter paper as time passes? Do you obtain different colors? Can you think why this happens? We observe that as time passes, water seeps of the upper paper carrying the dye with it. As the water rises on the filter paper, it takes along with it the dye particles. After some time, we get different spots on the filter paper. This shows that the dye is not a single color. The ink that we use has water as a solvent and dye is soluble in it. The dye is usually a mixture of two or more colors. The colored components, which is more soluble in water, rises faster, and in this way different colors get separated. The different components from their spots at different places. This process of separation of components is called chromatography. The name comes from the Greek word chroma, meaning color, because this technique was first of all used for the separation of colors. Chromatography has been used for separation of those solutes which dissolve in the same solvent. This has also been used to identify unknown substances. With the advancement of technology, newer techniques of chromatography have been developed. Now, what are the applications of chromatography? The main applications of chromatography is to separate colors in a dye, pigments from natural colors, amino acids, sugar from urine sample, drugs from blood. So this technique is finding use in science laboratories and hospitals. Now here goes new topic of this chapter, physical change and chemical change. You have learned about physical and chemical changes in your previous classes. Let us recall about these. Physical change, a change in which chemical identity or chemical composition of the substance does not change. It is a purely temporary change in which only the physical properties of the substances such as color, volume, shape, state, etc. may change. It can be easily reversed by changing the conditions and is therefore reversible in nature. Transformation of states is a physical change because these changes occur without a change in composition and do not change the chemical nature of the substance. Although ice, water and water vapor appear to be different and show different physical properties, yet they are chemically same. The common example of physical changes are conversion of water into steam or ice are physical changes. Dissolution of sugar in water is also a physical change. In solution, sugar and water retain their identity. Water can be evaporated from the sugar solution and sugar can be recovered. Conversion of a piece of iron into a magnet, heating of iron ball to redness,
while on cooling come to its original condition, glowing of electric bulb, breaking a piece of wood into smaller pieces, dissolution of sugar in water because the properties of both sugar and water do not change, and boiling of water. Now, chemical change. It is a change in which identity or chemical composition of the substances changes. In a chemical change, one or more kinds of matter are transformed into a new kind of matter or several kinds of matter. It is a permanent change and cannot be easily reversed. A chemical change is also called a chemical reaction. For example, when iron is exposed to oxygen, it rusts. Rusting is due to the formation of a new substances from or iron oxide. When magnesium ribbon is burnt in oxygen, it forms a magnesium oxide. Burning of candle to give carbon dioxide and water is also chemical change. Reaction of zinc metal with hydrochloric acid and electrolysis of matter. So here is the difference between physical change and chemical change. Now moving on further, the types of pure substances. On the basis of their chemical composition, the substances can be classified as elements and compounds. Elements. Robert Boyle was the first scientist to use the term element in 1661. He said that element could not be broken down into simpler substances. This definition of an element is still applicable. Antoine Laurent, or Lavoisier, a French chemist, was the first to establish an experimentally useful definition of an element. According to him, an element may be defined as a substance which can neither be broken down into simpler substances nor formed from two or more simpler substances by any known physical or chemical process. For example, hydrogen is an element because it cannot be split up into or more simpler substances by the usual methods of carrying out chemical reactions by applying heat, light and electricity. The common examples of elements are hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, iron, gold, copper, mercury, sulfur, etc. They are more than 112 elements known at present. Out of these, about 92 have so far been found to occur naturally, and the remaining 20 have been prepared in the laboratories. All these elements do not occur in the crust of Earth to the same proportion. The most abundant elements in the Earth's crust are oxygen, silicon, aluminium, iron, calcium, sodium, potassium, magnesium, hydrogen, chlorine, carbon, etc. From these elements, all other substances on the Earth are made. Thus, the elements are regarded as the building blocks of the universe. Oxygen and silicon are most common elements and they are the major constituents of sand, soil and rocks. Oxygen also occurs as free elements in the atmosphere and the combination with hydrogen in water. The most common elements found in a body are oxygen, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, calcium, phosphorus, etc. Elements may be solid, liquid and gases. Among all the known elements, only mercury and bromine are liquids at room temperature. Hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, chlorine and noble gases like helium, neon, argon, etc. are gases, while all other elements are solids. Now, we will discuss here about metals and non-metals. First of all, metals. Metals are good conductors of heat and electricity. They have luster, mean shine, and can be polished. They have silvery gray or golden yellow color. They are ductile, that is, can be drawn into wires. They are malleable, that is, can be beaten with a hammer into thin sheets without breaking. Metals are hard and have high melting and boiling point. Metals have high densities. Most of the metals are sonorous, that is, they make a ringing sound when hit with an object. The common examples of metals are sodium, potassium, zinc, copper, silver, gold, aluminium, iron, etc. Now, non-metals. Non-metals usually shows the following properties. Non-metals are poor conductors of heat and electricity. They are non-lustrous and cannot be polished. They have variety of colors. They are soft and brittle. They are neither malleable nor ductile. They are not sonorous. Non-metals generally have low melting and boiling points. They have low densities. Examples of non-metals are hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, iodine, carbon, bromine, phosphorus, etc. About 80% of the elements are metals and the remaining 20% are non-metals. All the metals are solids except mercury, which is liquid. As we have learned, bromine is also liquid at room temperature, but it is non-metal. Some compounds have intermediate properties between those of metals and non-metals. They show some properties of metals and some properties of non-metals. These are called metalloids. The common examples of metalloids are silver, germanium, arsenic, antimony, etc. Now, we will discuss about compounds. A compound is a pure substance made up of two or more elements chemically combined with one another in a fixed proportions by mass. It may be noted that pure compounds, whatever it is, source always contains definite or constant proportions of elements by mass. For example, water is composed of two elements, hydrogen and oxygen. Irrespective of its source, all samples of pure water contain these elements combined together in the ratio of 1:8 by mass. The compound can be formed by different chemical methods from their constituent elements. Alternately, it can also be decomposed into their constituent elements by different chemical methods. For example, water is a compound made up of two elements, hydrogen and oxygen. It can be formed by the chemical compositions of hydrogen and oxygen in a fixed proportion of 1:8 by mass. Here you can see the example of salt also and the example of carbon dioxide also. Now, properties of compounds. The main properties of compounds are: a chemical compound consists of two or more elements combined together in a fixed proportion by mass. Second property, the properties of a compounds are entirely different from those of its constituent elements. Third property, the constituent elements of a compound cannot be separated by mechanical or physical method. Fourth property, the compound is a homogeneous substance. This means that a compound has same composition throughout. Fifth one, a compound has a fixed melting point and boiling point. Sixth one, the formation of a compound occurs because of a chemical reaction and is accompanied by energy changes. So this was all about chapter number 2, is matter around us pure?